What's going on, guys? Welcome back. And today we're going to be continuing my painting up some D&D models. There's a few things that I've learned from doing this. I'm not sure whether it was the model itself or the paints that I use, although it's the paint that I always use. And the Xenophil highlight is just the white ink. One of these models was being a little bit sort of agoraphobic, rejecting the paint, or the acrylic paint at least. So I'm not sure whether that's because it's a resin 3D print or just something happened to the process. But the other things I want to be doing in this is getting textures sorted out, sort of teaching myself techniques to get textures painted, so like fur texture, leathers, and skin. I always feel like I'm not the greatest at doing skin and faces, so I want to try and improve on that by painting up these models, which is why I chose the dwarf. He's got quite a lot of exposed skin, and the hunter, because there was a lot of fur to be done on that, and it had the large animal, or the what I think is supposed to be a panther, but I've done a scaled up ginger tabby, so yeah, why not? Oh, and also the winning color scheme, woo, is this one up on the screen right now. So that is how we're going to be painting our Tau from now on. So there's going to be a community post going live very soon, which is going to have all the options for the Tau kill team. And we're going to go through, and the top votes on that is going to determine what our Tau will consist of for that kill team. And then after that, we'll start working on our army. I'm going to try and do at least one of these videos a month to sort of spread the cost out a bit. So I'm not going totally, I'm just not going hungry because I'm buying lots of Tau. Also, in this video, there's going to be a sneak peek. At what is coming next and very soon for a diorama that I'm going to be building. So keep an eye out for that. It's just going to flash up quickly, and that's all I'm going to give you until the video drops for that. And I am mega excited for it. So if you want to see that, make sure you like, share, subscribe, stick around, send a comment. Love having you here. Anyway, let's get on with this painting and see how it goes. So I don't really use my airbrush a lot when I'm painting up miniatures. That's for a good reason, is the fact that I prefer using a paintbrush. But I wanted to sort of start to incorporate it a bit more because I want to do a 24-hour challenge at some point, and I know I'm going to be relying on an airbrush a bit more than I normally would do. So this is, I'm just doing a little bit of practicing with the Xenophil highlight and using a contrast paint to go over the top of that to see how the effect comes through, and I have to say I was really happy with it. Those white highlights going in contrast with the black with the paint over the top left it looking really nice. I'm sure you could do this with a brush as well, but I just wanted to do this with an airbrush, mostly for myself to see how it's getting along. So if you do have an airbrush, I would suggest that you try this for capes, because it was quick and easy and it was done in moments. Also, once I was done with it, I came in with the paintbrush just to catch those little bits of the edge that I didn't quite, well, I had covered up with my sort of little mock shield that I put together, and it gave the same effect. So this works with paintbrush or with airbrush. Either way, worked quite nicely. So now we know that's tick in the box for that one, I suppose. So as I was saying earlier, or if I didn't say earlier, it's probably because I cut it out and re-scripted myself. But here's where I found the paint was being a bit agoraphobic. I've had to record this so many times trying to say that bloody word. I wasn't quite sure why. I don't know whether it was because of the ink that I've got on there. I don't know. I've used these paints that I use all the time, and I just wasn't quite understanding. But we got past it. I just ended up putting a slightly thicker layer on than what I would have liked to have. But it sort of got me around that corner. So if you ever come across the paint sort of rejecting and beading up and not clinging to the surface properly, just bite the bullet, put a slightly thicker layer on than you would have initially liked to have, but it will resolve that issue for you. Don't go mental and put a massive slop on, just a bit more than you normally would, and keep adding until it grips. That's what I found worked. There may be other ways around it, and I'm sure people will mention it in the comments. So keep an eye out for those if people do mention it. So what do I mean by this? Well, what I'm trying to sort of get across is the fact that, like you,
I also look at things sometimes and go, oh God, what colour am I going to bloody put in this one? Or what am I going to use for that? I don't want to use the same colour again and again and again. Well, what I've done here is I've started with Rhydox Hide as sort of like the base colour for a lot of different, for all the leather areas, or all the areas that I think are going to be like a cloth or leather. And then I've built up different shades of brown on top of that. So I've used Zandra Dust and or Shampty Bone, or I've used Steel Lesion Drab and then just Zandra Dust and not put the Obshampty on it. And I've sort of done it like that. So it's had different layers, different highlight layers to it. And also, I think one of them, I even went in with Morfang Brown and Deathclaw Brown on top, or Doomball Brown. I don't make notes. I need to make notes. Maybe I should actually script these instead of just freeballing it every time.
The main point that I'm trying to get across is that don't be afraid to use the same base colour, because it doesn't have to lead the direction. It don't have to stick to the same recipe of paint every time. Mix them up, chop and change, and you will get different results. And it's all sort of kept and drawn together in one sort of, keeps it all unified with that same depth and that same base colour, but totally different results as the for the end play. So apparently I didn't film doing the scabbards for the sword, which is the leather effect that I really did think I had painted, because I did a sort of a cross-hatching effect on the leather to give it a nice sort of leathery scratched effect. So hopefully I do show it in a bit so I can pause and go, aha, there it is, have a look at that. So here's one I made earlier. Anyway, when I say it looks golden, what we're going to be doing now is just going over doing some fine detail on this gold chain that I just imagined that he would have. And we're going to go around and do some of the metal work, mixing it up between silver and gold, and then putting a wash over all the metallics that we've got going on here, and then going over the top of that to give them a nice worn look, so they look nice and scratched up and well used, which I'm sure they would be. So I'm going to say it, I don't think I did a very good job of this face. The paint again was being a bit agoraphobic. I was really sort of struggling as to why this was happening with this model. But these things happen, you know, mistakes are made. What can we do but learn from them? So I put too thick a layer on with this first layer, and I don't think that helped the end result later. But what I did do is I used three different skin tones. You can choose your own, but I started with Cadian Flesh and then moved up to the lightest lightest tone was Blade One Flesh. You can choose your own, or you can just mix your two together so that you've got a bit of unity in those continuing layers going up. Also, I didn't film this one very well. I kept going out of shot. But anyway, so I once I put this layer down, I then did a wash of Reckling Flesh Shade, I think. Is that what it's called? I don't know. You know what I'm on about, I'm sure. Once that had dried, I then went over the same paint, same colour that I'm painting on now, and then I built up from there. Also tried to do the eyes. I think they didn't, you know, they weren't the best, but they weren't the worst. I've sort of decided not to repaint it and leave it as a little bit of an example to myself for later on when I look back at this model and go, yeah, I definitely could have done a better job on that one. But I feel like I did a lot better when I came to painting the dwarf in a moment. So let's just get past this moment in our lives, and have a look, make your own judgment on it. I know I've made mine. So I've done a few different sort of like techniques and effects and ideas have gone into painting this, and also to try and make it look like it's got fur when there's been no fur sculpted onto it. So I got my base colours down first, which as you can see is this sort of cream colour and the orange. And then what I did was I mixed some brown into the orange colour, and that I used that to make the lines, well, the very distinctive lines that go over on a tabby cat, because they're not cream like I thought they were. Anyway, I got all my lines done. I got everything sort of planned out before I went in and did the final effect to give it sort of a fur feel. So, and that involved a lot of stippling. So these lines, these sort of very harsh lines that you can see between the cream and the orange, I did a nice, very dry amount of paint, so not a lot of paint on the brush. Did a stippling across all of it to sort of blend it in to the rest to make it have that fur feel to it. And then I went over everything in a stippling effect just to make it sort of look like it's got that rough fur texture to it. So let's have a look and see how that has worked out, I suppose. So in order to try and keep this video as short as possible, I'm just going to say this. The same processes that I'm doing on this dwarf are the same processes that I've been doing on all these models so far. But I think you can really sort of see it really start to come together on this last model, because I've taken my time to paint everything up, and that in itself I feel has really, just in these last two models, I feel like I've improved leaps and bounds to how I was painting beforehand. I've got a different approach and a different way of going at it now. So I'm glad that I did this little experiment to paint up some models that I would never have painted before. And anyway, here we go, guys. I'm going to speed it up. We're going to fire on through. We'll see the end results, and I'll let you guys be the judges. But I feel like this has all really helped, especially myself. So if it's helped me get better at painting, I'm sure you guys give this a go, you'll get better yourselves. So I'm a massive advocate for using the cheapest methods possible, which is why I use shot glasses and a bit of blue tack. Hence with my whole will it paint handle. Yeah, as long as I can blue tack it to something, it's gonna be a paint handle. That will be returning at some point, don't worry. So this is, the dwarf has snapped off, his foot has snapped, and luckily it's just come away at the glue point on his other foot, so that hasn't broken. But I'm assuming this is a 3D print issue, because I have never had this happen with any of my other models which I've blue tacked down before, and that's a lot of models that I've used blue tack, and this is the first time it's happened. It's only an assumption that it's a 3D print issue, so I could be wrong, or I could be spot on, bang on the money. Didn't do anything different when I took it off, this just happened. I like to keep it real with you guys. Anyway, Yeah, there it is. Guys, I really hope you enjoyed this one. As I said, next video we are going to be going back to Dire Armors. And I really do hope to see you in the next one.